Good morning, everybody, and happy Sunday. I'm so happy that you're here. I'm glad that every single one of you are here this morning. You know, kind of reminds me, last week we had a woman in our service, and she's kind of new to our church, been here just a few weeks, and she was seated right over here. We came to the part where you greet each other, and you go around and shake hands and all that kind of stuff. So I went up to her, and I was trying to greet her, welcome her, and I put my hand out like this. She said, oh, no, and I thought, oh, what did I do there? And she said, I see you giving out hugs around this place. I want to get me one of them. So I said, bring it in. You know. Well, I'm so excited to see you. I wish that I could go around and give every single one of you a hug just for being here this morning, for coming out and sharing this morning with us. I know you're saying, Jeff, that's just kind of weird. Well, hey, I'm glad you're here. We're in a series right now called Relational Vampires. Relational Vampires. And what we're doing is we're talking about these difficult relationships that we have in life, the kind of relationships that drain you, that suck the life out of you, suck the joy out of your day. And today, I hate to tell you this, this is going to be kind of a difficult day for us, because today we're going to talk about a very, very sensitive subject. And to be honest, it's kind of a silent subject. It's one that we don't like to talk about very much. But I feel like if we're doing a series on painful relationships, difficult relationships, this is something that we need to address head on. Because today we're going to talk about the issue of abuse in relationships. Whether that's bullying or verbal abuse, physical abuse, sexual abuse, emotional abuse. Now let me just tell you some pretty shocking statistics so you understand why I think we need to address this. Do you know that the number one cause of injury to women is domestic violence? The number one cause is violence done by someone they live with, someone in their own family. In fact, it's more common than the next three types of injuries combined. Every 9 seconds in the United States, a woman is assaulted or beaten. Every 9 seconds. Around the world, one out of every three women has been beaten, abused, or forced into sex. One out of three. How about this one? One out of five teenage girls. One out of five teenage girls has already been in a relationship with someone where their boyfriend or partner has threatened violence if they broke up. Now, some of us guys are here this morning going like, man, I'm sure glad I wasn't born a girl, you know, that I didn't have to grow up in this world. Let me tell you something. That's starting to change a little bit. According to a recent study by the University of New Hampshire, they did a 32-country study, and they found that it's not one-sided anymore. Today, women commit half of all domestic partner violence. So listen, given those statistics, I know that right now, as I look into your eyes, I know that either A, you have been a victim of abuse at some point in your life, or B, you know somebody. You know somebody who's been a victim of abuse. So the question that we want to look at this morning is this: how do you break free from that kind of relationship? How do you help someone you care about, break free from that kind of relationship? Well, I got to tell you, the very first step of getting yourself free is this: don't keep it a secret. If you're going to take notes right now, that's number one that you want to write down. Don't keep it a secret. Nothing is going to change in your life until you do one thing: tell someone. It's the most common thing in the world to think, I can't tell anyone what goes on in my house. But the Bible says you've got to learn to share your pain. Share your pain with someone you can trust. The Bible says the truth will set you free. One of the sayings that we learn in a recovery program, in a 12-step program, is I'm only as sick as my secrets. That's true, isn't it? I'm only as sick as my secrets. What we keep buried inside of us is what makes us sick. And the way to deal with an illness is to find a way to get it out. Get it out of your system. Maybe you've heard this saying, revealing my feeling is the beginning of healing. Revealing my feeling is the beginning of healing. Whatever you've got going on inside of you, whatever emotion is in there, locked away, whether that's anger, or hurt or shame or whatever it is, that emotion is already dominating you. It is already controlling your life and your thinking to some extent. You got to find a way to get that out. And what happens with abuse is it does this crazy thing in our brain. It just changes the way we think, and pretty soon it creates within us feelings of shame. It creates feelings of shame in us. And so we don't want to talk about it with anybody. We don't want to get help. We don't want to open up about what's going on. Let me tell you this, if you don't get anything else of what I say to you this morning, get this. You're not to blame. It's not your fault. You say, yeah, but I, no. It's not your fault. You are not responsible for the wrong, sinful actions of another person. And I want to say this to you as your pastor who loves you. God doesn't blame you. God doesn't blame you for any of that. God cares about you. This church cares about you. There is hope. You don't have to stay in that cycle of fear and pain any longer. But first, you got to stop being silent. We have people in our church even who are trained counselors if you need them. And then, don't rationalize it. Number two, don't rationalize it, don't minimize it, don't excuse it. The Bible says don't be fooled by those who try to excuse these sins. So you don't want to say things like, well, he was just having a bad day. Or, well, I brought this on myself. Or, there are so many good things in him, so many good things in her. No, you don't minimize it. You don't rationalize it. You don't excuse it. And then the third key to helping someone who's being abused is get them to a safe place. Number three, get them to a safe place. Maybe they've got to get out of that volatile situation. So you need to help them come up with an escape plan. And let me say this as clearly as I can. Read my lips on this. If you are getting physically or sexually abused, you need to get out. Now. Not someday. Now. Listen to me as your pastor. Listen to me as one who has a doctorate in theology. There is not a single verse in the entire Bible that says that you have to remain in a situation where your life is being threatened, where you're being sexually abused. There is not a single verse in the entire Bible that gives permission to someone to dominate you or control you or use you. And anybody who tells you that there is just perverting scripture. You need to get out of that relationship right now. And don't go back to that person. Don't walk in that house again if you're going back to the same old thing. Don't go back until God has changed you and God has changed them. And then one more thing to protect yourself. Don't confront your abuser by yourself. It's just common sense. Number four, don't confront an abuser by yourself. Don't say, yeah, boy, that message today just hit home with me. That was God talking to me today. So I'm going to leave this church, and before I chicken out, I'm going to go right home and I'm going to confront him right now. I'm going to walk into that house today and I'm going to have it out with him. That is neither wise nor safe. If you're dealing with a violent husband or you're dealing with somebody who's verbally abusive to you at work, don't try to handle that by yourself. Don't go to that person alone. You're asking for trouble. Solomon in the Bible, Solomon, who was famous for his wisdom, said to do difficult things together as a team. He said, by yourself, you're unprotected. With a friend, you could face the worst. Can you find a third person? Even better, a rope of three strands is not easily broken. In other words, it's better to go at it as a team. And by the way, keep this in mind. It may feel like that person who is abusive is the person who is in the position of power in the relationship. But it's important to remember that when somebody is acting abusive, It's always because they feel deep down insecurity within themselves. They have a deep sense of powerlessness within themselves. And so what they're trying to do is control the world around them. They're trying to dominate the people around them because they're so out of control. They're trying to dominate and control what they can. And then begin the healing process. Step five is where you really get to the point where you're starting the healing process. 5,000 years ago, Job in the Bible had a friend come up to him and give him some advice, and that advice is still good today. The friend said, Job, put your heart right. Reach out to God. Put away any evil and wrong in your home. Then face the world again firm and courageous. Then watch what happens. All your troubles will fade from your memory like floods that are past, remembered no more. Your life will be brighter than the sunshine at noon, and life's darkest hours will shine like the dawn. I want that all to be true for your life. As your pastor who loves you, I want every bit of that description to describe your life. Your troubles are beginning to fade away, receding like the floodwaters. I want your life to be brighter than the sunshine at noon. I want life's darkest hours to shine like the dawn for you. Now, how do you do that? Look again at that verse a little more carefully. It says, first of all, put your heart right. What does that mean? It means you make the courageous decision to do what's right. It takes courage to stop keeping a secret. It takes courage to speak up, and I'm praying that you've got that courage. Then it says, reach out to God. You need to turn to Jesus. Jesus is your Savior. They don't call him Savior for nothing. He came to save you from your abuse. He came to save you not only from your sins, but from the sins other people do against you. And then it says, put away the evil and the wrong from your house. Get away from the evil. Get out of your house. You may have to clean house emotionally, clean house relationally. And then and only then can those troubles begin to fade away like receding floodwaters, and the darkness will be over. Finally, there is one other thing that you ought to keep in mind. Let God settle the score. Number six, let God settle the score. Don't you try to get even with that person. I know they hurt you. But don't think you've got to hurt them back just as much as they hurt you. Let God deal with that person. You know, when you have a painful relationship with somebody, you've got three potential positions you can take in regard to that person. You can be beneath them morally. You can be even with them morally, or you can be above them. You can take the moral high ground. You can be better than them. Let me explain. If you hurt me and I've done nothing to deserve it, that makes you worse than me. You're on a lower moral level than me. If you hurt me, but I say, I'm going to hurt you back. I'm going to do the same thing right back to you. What have I done? I've just gotten even. I'm just getting even. Whenever you get even, you're no better than the perpetrator. You're just even. You're no better than they are. But when you forgive them, you're better than they are. You're on the higher ground. And isn't that where you want to be? Isn't that your goal as a follower of Jesus? Here's what the Bible says. Never repay one wrong with another, or one abusive word with another. In other words, you can cuss at me as much as you want. I'm not going to cuss back at you. You can be verbally abusive to me. I'm not going to yell back at you. Instead, repay with a blessing. Repay that person with a blessing. That is what you're called to do so that you inherit a blessing. If you want God's blessing on your life, you've got to be different from them. You can't act the way they do. And let me tell you this. If you have been physically or sexually abused, and maybe you're in that situation right now, there is one person in this entire universe who understands your situation completely. There is one person in this entire universe who knows exactly what you feel like and what you've been going through. And his name is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ understands abuse. The Bible says he was wounded and crushed. Sounds like abuse to me. Wounded and crushed for our sins. He was beaten and bruised. That's abuse. So that we could have peace. He was mocked and whipped so that we could be healed. If you've never met Jesus, your healing starts here. Your healing starts today. May I introduce you to your healer? His name is Jesus. Nobody has ever been more abused than Jesus. He knows pain because he was beaten and bruised and bloodied and nailed to a cross. He knows bullying because he was bullied, he was lied about, he was gossiped about, he was threatened. He took every act of abuse that has ever been done. He took it upon himself, and he died so that we could be healed. He knows guilt because he took our guilt upon himself. You've got to meet the healer before you'll ever be truly, deeply, emotionally healed. It's not going to happen on your own, because nothing crushes your spirit more than abuse. Being constantly demeaned and degraded and devalued, and Jesus knows that. And that's why he says to you, I'm always going to love you. I am always going to respect you. And he will. He will keep that promise. Jesus would tell you, if you want to start the healing right now, you got to let go of it today. Let go of it and let God settle the score. That's what Jesus did. The Bible says Christ never verbally abused those who verbally abused him. When he suffered, he didn't make any threats, but left everything to the one who judges fairly. See, one day, God is going to balance the books. One day, God is going to settle the score. One day, God is going to right all the wrongs. You think God is going to let people get away with all this? You think God is going to let people get away with all the evil that's happened in the world? Is Hitler going to get away with it? You think God is going to turn a blind eye to all the abuse and the molestation that you've seen, you've heard about, you've experienced? No, one day, God is going to settle the score. God is going to make things right. Our God is truly a just God. And so he can do a whole lot better job at making things right, at settling the score, than you can or I can. So I'm going to leave it in his hands, because he's God and I'm not. And let me just close with this. Look, I know this has been a tough message, because it brings up a lot of emotions. But one last problem that you need to deal with in a serious way is this. It is contagious. Abuse is highly, highly contagious. It gets passed from generation to generation. And if you saw it growing up, well, then you learned some patterns when you were a young person. And if you grew up with abuse in your home, you are twice as likely to be an abuser yourself. Somebody's got to break that chain, and it's going to be you. It's going to be you. Starting today, starting now, starting with the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. So let's bow our heads right now and let's go before God. And I know this has been a painful message for many of you, but no matter what you've gone through, whether you have been abused or the abuser, whether you have been the victim or the victimizer, there's a way out. I want you to know that God cares about you. This church cares about you. And I care about you. You don't have to stay in that pain anymore. There is healing available for both the victims and the victimizers. And it starts by accepting God into your life. I'm going to pray a prayer right now, and I invite you to pray this in your heart. Just say, Dear Lord Jesus. You just say that in your heart, maybe even in your own words. Dear Lord Jesus, I need salvation in so many ways. I am a sinner, and I need to be saved. I am hurt, and I need your help. I need to be healed from my pain. I need to be free from my past. I need to have the power to develop new patterns. I need a new mind, a new heart, a new outlook. I need a new me. So Lord, today I ask you to come into my heart and into every area of my life, even the secret places, even the dark places. Start doing your work. Shine the light. And you know what? If you prayed that prayer, God heard you. With heads still bowed, why don't you just thank God for hearing you? Say, Lord Jesus, thank you for hearing my prayer today. Thank you for saving me. Now help me take the tough steps to grow into the man or woman you want me to be. I want the pain of the past to flood away, and I want the light to be as bright as noonday. Father, I want to thank you for every person in this room today and for many, many more listening online and on the radio. I pray a blessing. I pray a blessing of courage that this week many will say, I'm not going to keep it a secret anymore. I'm not going to rationalize it. I'm not going to minimize it. I'm not going to excuse it. The cycle stops with me. If I need to find a safe place, so be it. Let the healing process begin. And God, I'm going to let you settle the score. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.